Recorded Books and One Click Digital present City of Fortune, How Venice Ruled the Seas by Roger Crowley, narrated by Edoardo Ballerini. One Click Digital provides free audiobook downloads in partnership with thousands of public libraries. To see if One Click Digital's extensive catalogue is available to you, visit your library's website. The author opens with a quote from Leonicus Chalcandiles, a 15th century Byzantine historian. "The people of Venice neither have any foothold on the mainland, nor can they cultivate the earth. They are compelled to import everything they need by sea. It's through trade that they have accumulated such great wealth." And now, City of Fortune.
Prologue. Departure. Late in the evening of April 9th, 1363, the poet and scholar Francesco Petrarch was writing to a friend. The Venetian Republic had granted the great literary figure of the age an imposing house on the waterfront, overlooking the basin of St. Mark, from where he could survey all the rich hubbub of the city's port. Petrarch was drowsing over his letter when he was jolted rudely awake. It was completely dark. The sky was stormy. I was tired, when suddenly the shouting of sailors struck my ears. Remembering the meaning of this from previous occasions, I hurriedly got up and climbed to the top of this house, which surveys the harbor. I looked out. Good God, what a sight! At once touching, marvelous, frightening, and exhilarating. Here in the harbor, there were some sailing ships, which had moored at the marble quayside over the winter, as massive as this great house, which the most generous of cities has put at my disposal. Their masts rise as high as its square corner towers. At this very moment, while the stars are muffled by thick cloud, while my walls are shaken by blasts of wind, while the sea roars and bellows horribly, the largest of them casts off on its voyage. If you'd seen this vessel, you would have said it was not a boat, but a mountain swimming on the surface of the sea, and so heavily laden with a huge quantity of cargo that the great part of its bulk was hidden beneath the waves. It is setting out for the River Don, for this is as far as our ships can sail on the Black Sea, but many of those on board will disembark and journey on, not stopping until they have crossed the Ganges and the Caucasus to India, then on to farthest China and the Eastern Ocean. What is the source of this insatiable thirst for wealth that seizes men's minds? I confess, I was gripped by compassion for these unfortunate men. I understand now why the poets rightly call the sailor's life wretched. Petrarch the landlubber was awed by the outsized ambition of this enterprise. The humanist poet was disturbed by the fierce materialism that propelled it. For the Venetians themselves, such departures were the stuff of daily life. In a city where every man could row, the experience of embarkation, the drift from land to sea, was almost as unconscious as crossing the threshold of your house. A ferry across the Grand Canal, a gondola to Murano or Torcello, a night's crabbing in the eerie reaches of the lagoon, the heady departure of an armed war fleet to the blare of trumpets, the seasonal sailings of the great merchant galleys on the regular run to Alexandria or Beirut. These were deep, cyclical experiences of a whole people. Embarkation was a central metaphor of the city's life, endlessly repeated in art. A mosaic boat in St. Mark's Basilica departs with swelling sails to carry the eponymous saint's body to Venice. Carpaccio's St. Ursula treads a realistic gangplank into a rowing boat, while the high-sided merchant ships wait offshore. Canaletto catches Venice setting sail in holiday mood. Leave-taking was accompanied by elaborate rituals. All seafarers would commit their souls to the Virgin and St. Mark. St. Nicholas was also a firm favorite, and stops would be made at his church on the Lido for a last prayer. Significant enterprises would be prefaced by services, and ships were routinely blessed. Crowds gathered on the waterfront, Then the ropes were cast off. For Felix Fabbri, a pilgrim on his way to the Holy Land in the 15th century, the launch happened just before dinner time. All the pilgrims aboard, and the wind fair, the three sails were spread to the sound of trumpets and horns, and we sailed out to the open sea. Once through the barrier of the sheltering sandbars of the lagoon islands, the Lidi, ships passed into the open sea and another world. Departure, risk, profit, glory. These were the compass points of Venetian life. Voyaging was a repeated experience. For nearly 1,000 years, the citizens of Venice knew no other. The sea was at once their protection, their opportunity, and their fate. Secure in their shallow lagoon with its deceptive channels and treacherous mudflats that no invader could penetrate, shielded if not insulated from the surge of the Adriatic, they wrapped the sea around them like a cloak. They changed its gender from the masculine mare to the feminine mar in the Venetian dialect, and every year on Ascension Day, they married it. This was an act of appropriation. The bride and all her dowry became property of the husband. But it was also one of propitiation. The sea was danger and uncertainty. It could and did smash ships, hasten enemies, and periodically threaten to overwhelm the defenses of the low-lying city. The voyage could be terminated by an arrow shot or a rising sea or disease. Death came in a shroud weighted with stones and dropped into the lower depths. The maritime relationship would be long, intense, and ambivalent. Not until the 15th century did any Venetian seriously question whether the marriage should be with land rather than water. And during this time, they moved up the gradient from eel trappers, salt panners, and bargemen on the slow inland rivers of northern Italy to merchant princes and coiners of gold. The sea brought the fragile city, existing like a mirage on its tenuous oak pilings, riches beyond measure, and a maritime empire as splendid as any. In the process, Venice shaped the world. This book is the story of the rise of that empire, the Stato da Mar, they called it in dialect, and the commercial wealth it created. The Crusades provided the Republic with its chance to ascend the world stage. The Venetians took the opportunity with both hands and profited hugely. Over 500 years, they became masters of the Eastern Mediterranean and nicknamed their city La Dominante. When the sea turned against them, they mounted an exhaustive rearguard action and fought to the last breath. The empire that they constructed was already well advanced by the time Petrarch looked from his window. It was a curious, cobbled-together affair, a collection of islands, ports, and strategic bastions, designed solely to harbor its ships and channel goods back to the mother city. Its construction was a story of courage and duplicity, luck, persistence, opportunism, and periodic catastrophe. Above all, the story of the Stato da Mar is a saga about trade. Alone in all the world, Venice was organized to buy and sell. The Venetians were merchants to their fingertips. They calculated risk, return, and profit with scientific precision. The red and gold lion banner of St. Mark fluttered from mastheads like a corporate logo. Trade was their creation myth and their justification, for which they were frequently reviled by more terrestrial neighbors. There exists no more explicit description of the city's raison d'etre and its anxieties than the appeal it made to the Pope in 1343 for permission to trade with the Muslim world. Since, by the grace of God, our city has grown and increased by the labors of merchants creating traffic and profits for us in diverse parts of the world by land and sea, and this is our life and that of our sons, because we cannot live otherwise, and know not how except by trade. Therefore we must be vigilant in all our thoughts and endeavors, as our predecessors were, to make provision in every way, lest so much wealth and treasure should disappear. The appeal's gloomy conclusion echoes a manic depressive streak in the Venetian soul. The city's prosperity rested on nothing tangible. No land holdings, no natural resources, no agricultural production or large population. There was literally no solid ground underfoot. Physical survival depended on a fragile ecological balance. Venice was perhaps the first virtual economy whose vitality baffled outsiders. It harvested nothing but barren gold and lived in perpetual fear that if its trade routes were severed, the whole magnificent edifice might simply collapse. There is a moment when the departing vessels shrink to vanishing point, and the watchers on the quay turn back to normal life. Sailors resume their tasks. Stevedores heft bales and roll barrels. Gondoliers paddle on. Priests hurry to the next service. Black-robed senators return to the weighty cares of state. The cutpurse makes off with his takings, and the ships surge out into the Adriatic. Petrarch watched until he could see no more. When my eyes could no longer follow the ships through the darkness, I picked up my pen again, shaken and deeply moved. It had been arrival, however, rather than departure, which launched the Stato da Mar. 160 years earlier, in Lent 1201, six French knights were rowed across the lagoon to Venice. They had come about a crusade. Part 1. Opportunity. Merchant Crusaders. 1000 to 1204. Chapter 1. Lords of Dalmatia. 1000 to 1198. The Adriatic Sea is the liquid reflection of Italy, a tapering channel some 480 miles long and 100 wide, pinched together at its southern point where it flows into the Ionian past the island of Corfu. At its most northern point, in the enormous curved bay called the Gulf of Venice, the water is a curious blue-green. Here the River Po churns out tons of alluvial material from the distant Alps, which settle to form haunting stretches of lagoon and marsh. So great is the volume of these glacial deposits that the Po Delta is advancing 15 feet a year, and the ancient port of Adria, after which the sea is named, now lies 14 miles inland. Geology has made the Adriatic's two coasts quite distinct. The western Italian shore is a curved, low-lying beach, which provides poor harbors but ideal landing spots for would-be invaders. Sail due east, and your vessel will snub against limestone. The shores of Dalmatia and Albania are a 400-mile stretch as the crow flies, but so deeply crenellated with sheltering coves, indents, offshore islands, reefs, and shoals that they comprise 2,000 miles of intricate coast. Here are the sea's natural anchorages, which may shelter a whole fleet or conceal an ambush. Behind these features, sometimes stepped back by coastal plain, sometimes hard down on the sea, stand the abrupt white limestone mountains that barricade the sea from the upland Balkans. The Adriatic is the frontier between two worlds. For thousands of years, from the early Bronze Age until well after the Portuguese rounded Africa, this fault line was a marine highway linking Central Europe with the Eastern Mediterranean, and a portal for world trade. Ships passed up and down the sheltering Dalmatian shore with the goods of Arabia, Germany, Italy, the Black Sea, India, and the farthest east. Over the centuries, they carried Baltic amber to the burial chamber of Tutankhamun, blue faience beads from Mycenae to Stonehenge, Cornish tin to the smelters of the Levant, the spices of Malacca to the courts of France, Cotswold wool to the merchants of Cairo. Timber, slaves, cotton, copper, weapons, seeds, stories, inventions, and ideas sailed up and down these coasts. "It is astonishing," wrote a 13th-century Arab traveler about the cities of the Rhine, "that although this place is in the far west, there are spices there which are to be found only in the far east. Pepper, ginger, cloves, spikenard, costus, and galanga, all in enormous quantities." They came up the Adriatic. This was the point where hundreds of arterial routes converged. From Britain and the North Sea, down the River Rhine, along beaten tracks through the Teutonic forests, across Alpine passes, mule trains threaded their way to the top of the Gulf, where the merchandise of the East also landed. Here goods were transshipped and ports flourished, first Greek Adria, then Roman Aquileia, and finally, Venice. In the Adriatic, sight is everything. Adria silted up. Aquileia on the coastal plain was flattened by Attila the Hun in 452. Venice prospered in the aftermath because it was unreachable. Its smattering of low-lying, muddy islets set in a malarial lagoon was separated from the mainland by a few precious miles of shallow water. This unpromising place would become the entrepot and interpreter of worlds. The Adriatic, its passport. From the start, the Venetians were different. The first, rather idyllic snapshot we have of them, from the Byzantine legate Cassiodorus in 523, suggests a unique way of life, independent and democratic. You possess many vessels, and you live like seabirds, with your homes dispersed across the surface of the water. The solidity of the earth on which they rest is secured only by osier and wattle, yet you do not hesitate to oppose so frail a bulwark to the wildness of the sea. Your people have one great wealth, the fish, which suffices for them all. Among you there is no difference between rich and poor. Your food is the same, your houses are alike. Envy, which rules the rest of the world, is unknown to you. All your energies are spent on your salt fields. In them indeed lies your prosperity, and your power to purchase those things which you have not. For though there may be men who have little need of gold, yet none live who desire not salt. The Venetians were already carriers and suppliers of other men's needs. Theirs was a city grown hydroponically, conjured out of marsh, existing perilously on oak palings sunk in mud. It was fragile to the sea's whim, impermanent. Beyond the mullet and eels of the lagoon and its salt pans, it produced nothing. No wheat, no timber, little meat. It was terribly vulnerable to famine. Its sole skills were navigation and the carrying of goods. The quality of its ships was critical. Before Venice became the wonder of the world, it was a curiosity. Its social structure enigmatic, and its strategies distrusted. Without land, there could be no feudal system, no clear division between knight and serf. Without agriculture, money was its barter. Its nobles would be merchant princes who could command a fleet and calculate profit to the nearest grosso. The difficulties of life bound all its people together in an act of patriotic solidarity that required self-discipline and a measure of equality, like the crew of a ship, all subject to the perils of the deep. Geographical position, livelihood, political institutions, and religious affiliations marked Venice out. It lived between two worlds, the land and the sea, the east and the west, yet belonging to neither. It grew up a subject of the Greek-speaking emperors in Constantinople and drew its art, its ceremonials, and its trade from the Byzantine world. Yet the Venetians were also Latin Catholics, nominal subjects to the Pope, Byzantium's Antichrist. Between such opposing forces, they struggled to maintain a particular freedom. The Venetians repeatedly defied the Pope, who responded by excommunicating the whole city. They resisted tyrannous solutions to government and constructed for themselves a republic, led by a doge, whom they shackled with so many restraints that he could receive no gift from foreigners more substantial than a pot of herbs. They were intolerant of overambitious nobles and defeated admirals whom they exiled or executed, and devised a voting system to check corruption as labyrinthine as the shifting channels of their lagoon. The tenor of their relations with the wider world was set early. The city wished to trade wherever profit was to be made without fear or favor. This was their rationale and their creed, and they pleaded it as a special case. It earned them widespread distrust. They said many things to excuse themselves, which I do not recollect, spat a 14th century churchman after watching the Republic wriggle free of yet another treaty, though he could undoubtedly remember the details painfully well, excepting that they are a quintessence and will belong neither to the church nor to the emperor, nor to the sea nor to the land. The Venetians were in trouble with both Byzantine emperors and popes as early as the 9th century for selling war materials to Muslim Egypt, and while purportedly complying with a ban on trade with Islamic countries around 828, they managed to spirit away the body of St. Mark from Alexandria under the noses of Muslim customs officials, hidden in a barrel of pork. Their standard excuse was commercial necessity. Because we cannot live otherwise, and know not how except by trade. Alone in all the world, Venice was organized for economic ends. By the 10th century, they were selling Oriental goods of extraordinary rarity at the important fairs at Pavia on the River Po. Russian ermine, purple cloth from Syria, silk from Constantinople. One monkish chronicler had seen the Emperor Charlemagne looking drab beside his retinue in Oriental cloth bought in Pavia from Venetian merchants. Particularly singled out for clerical tut-tutting was a multicolored fabric interwoven with the figures of birds, evidently an item of outrageous foreign luxury. To the Muslims, Venice traded back timber and slaves, literally Slavs, until that people became Christian. Venice was by now well placed at the head of the Adriatic to become the pivot of trade, and on the round turning of the millennium, Ascension Day in the year 1000, Doge Pietro Orseolo II, a man who excelled almost all the ancient doges in knowledge of mankind, set sail on an expedition that would launch the Republic's ascent to wealth, power, and maritime glory. On the threshold of a new era, the city stood finely poised between danger and opportunity. Venice was not yet the compact mirage of dazzling stone that it would later become, though its population was already substantial. No splendid palazzi flanked the great S-bend of the Grand Canal. The city of wonder, flamboyance, and sin, of carnival masks and public spectacle, lay centuries ahead. Instead, low wooden houses, wharves, and warehouses fronted the water. Venice comprised less a unity than a succession of separate islets with patches of undrained marsh and open spaces among the parish settlements where people grew vegetables, kept pigs and cows, and tended vines. The Church of St. Mark, a plain predecessor of the extraordinary basilica, had recently been badly burned and patched up after political turmoil that had left a doge dead in its porch. The square in front of it was beaten earth, divided by a canal and partially given over to an orchard. Seagoing vessels that had sailed to Syria and Egypt crowded the commercial heart of the city, the Rivo Alto, contracted over time into the Rialto. Everywhere masts and spars protruded above the buildings. It was the genius of Orseolo to fully understand that Venice's growth, perhaps its very survival, lay far beyond the waters of the lagoon. He had already obtained favorable trading agreements with Constantinople, and to the disgust of militant Christendom, he dispatched ambassadors to the four corners of the Mediterranean to strike similar agreements with the Islamic world. The future for Venice lay in Alexandria, Syria, Constantinople, and the Barbary coast of North Africa, where wealthier, more advanced societies promised spices, silk, cotton, and glass, luxurious commodities that the city was ideally placed to sell on into northern Italy and central Europe. The problem for Venetian sailors was that the voyage down the Adriatic was terribly unsafe. The city's home waters, the Gulf of Venice, lay within its power, but the central Adriatic was risky to navigate, as it was patrolled by Croat pirates. Since the 8th century, these Slav settlers from the Upper Balkans had established themselves on its eastern Dalmatian shores. This was a terrain made for maritime robbery. From island lairs and coastal creeks, the shallow draft Croat ships could dart out and snatch merchant traffic passing down the strait. Venice had been conducting a running fight with these pirates for 150 years. The contest had yielded little but defeat and humiliation. One doge had been killed, leading a punitive expedition. Thereafter, the Venetians had opted to pay craven tribute for free passage to the open seas. The Croats were now seeking to extend their influence to the old Roman towns farther up the coast. Orseolo brought to this problem a clear strategic vision that would form the cornerstone of Venetian policy for all the centuries that the Republic lived. The Adriatic must provide free passage for Venetian ships, otherwise they would be forever bottled up. The Doge ordered that there would be no more tribute and prepared a substantial fleet to command obedience. Orseolo's departure was accompanied by one of those prescient ceremonies that became a defining marker of Venetian history. A large crowd assembled for a ritual mass at the Church of St. Peter at Castello, near the site of the present arsenal. The bishop presented the Doge with a triumphal banner, which perhaps depicted for the first time St. Mark's lion, gold and rampant on a red background, crowned and winged, ready for war, even as the open gospel between his paws declares peace. The Doge and his force then stepped aboard, and with the west wind billowing in their sails, surged out of the lagoon into the boisterous Adriatic. Stopping only to receive further blessings from the Bishop of Grado, they set sail for the peninsula of Istria on the eastern tip of the Adriatic. Orseolo's campaign could almost serve as the template for subsequent Venetian policy, a mixture of shrewd diplomacy and the precise application of force. As the fleet worked its way down the small coastal cities, from Parenzo to Pola, Ossero to Zara, the citizens and bishops came out to demonstrate their loyalty to the Doge and to bless him with their relics. Those who wavered, weighing Venice against the counter-threat of the Slavs, were more readily convinced by the visible show of force. The Croats saw what was coming and tried to buy the Doge off. Orseolo was not to be turned, though his task was made harder by the coastal terrain. The pirate stronghold was well protected, hidden up the marshy delta of the Narenta River and beyond the reach of any strike force. It was shielded by the three barrier islands of Lesina, Curzola, and Lagosta, whose rocky fortresses presented a tough obstacle. Relying on local intelligence, the Venetians ambushed a shipload of Narentine nobles returning from trade on the Italian shore and used them to force submission from the Croats at the mouth of the delta. The latter swore to forego the annual tribute and harassment of the Republic's ships. Only the offshore islands held out. The Venetians isolated them one by one and dropped anchor in their harbors. Curzola was stormed. Lagosta, by whose violence the Venetians who sailed through the seas were very often robbed of their goods and sent naked away, offered more stubborn resistance. The inhabitants believed their rocky citadel to be impregnable. The Venetians unleashed a furious assault on it from below. When that failed, a detachment made their way up by a steep path behind the citadel and captured the towers that contained the fort's water supply. The defense collapsed. The people were led away in chains, and their pirate's nest was demolished. With this force de frappe, Orseolo put down a clear marker of Venetian intentions, and in case any of the subject cities had forgotten their recent vows, he retraced his footsteps, calling at their startled ports in a repeat show of strength, parading hostages and captured banners. Thence, passing again by the aforesaid town, making his way back to Venice, he at length returned with great triumph. Henceforward, the Doge and his successors awarded themselves a new honorific title, Dux Dalmatiae, Lord of Dalmatia. If there is a single moment that marked the start of the rise to maritime empire, it was now, with the Doge's triumphal return to the lagoon. The breaking of the Narentine pirates was an act of great significance. It signaled the start of Venetian dominance of the Adriatic, and its maintenance became an axiom for all the centuries that the Republic lived. The Adriatic must be a Venetian sea. Nostra Caxa, our house in the local dialect, and its key was the Dalmatian coast. However, ensuring continued maritime dominance was never quite straightforward. Over the centuries and almost until its last breath, the Republic would spend enormous resources fending off imperial interlopers, cuffing pirates, and quelling troublesome vassals. The Dalmatian cities, particularly Zara, struggled repeatedly to assert their independence, but only Ragusa, present-day Dubrovnik, ever managed it. Henceforward, there was no rival naval power to match Venice in the heart of the sea. The Adriatic would fall under the political and economic shadow of an increasingly ravenous city, whose population would reach 80,000 within a century. In time, the limestone coast became the granary and vineyard of Venice. Istrian marble would front the Renaissance palaces on the Grand Canal. Dalmatian pine would plank the Republic's galleys, and its seamen would sail them out of Venetian naval bases on the eastern shore. The crenellated limestone coast came to be seen almost as an extension of the lagoon. The Republic, with a Byzantine talent for transforming significant victories into patriotic ceremonies, henceforth performed an annual celebration of Orseolo's triumph. Every Ascension Day, the people of Venice participated in a ritual voyage to the mouth of the lagoon. At the start, it was a relatively plain affair. The clergy, dressed in their copes and ceremonial robes, climbed aboard a barge decked with golden cloth and sailed out to the Lidi, the long line of sandbars that protects Venice from the Adriatic. They took a jar of holy water, salt, and olive branches out to where the lagoon opens to the sea at the Lido of St. Nicholas, the patron saint of sailors, and waited there, at the meeting of the two waters, for the doge to arrive in the ceremonial galley the Venetians called the Bucintoro, the golden boat. Rocking on the waves, the priests proclaimed a short and heartfelt prayer. Grant, O Lord, that the sea is always calm and quiet for us and all who sail on it. And then they approached the Bucintoro and sprinkled water over the doge and his followers with the olive branches and poured the remainder into the sea. In time, the Ascension Day ceremony, the Senza, would become greatly elaborated. But in the early years of the millennium, it was a simple act of blessing, a propitiation against storms and pirates, based on seasonal sailing rituals as ancient as Neptune and Poseidon. The miniature voyage enacted the whole meaning of Venice. Within the lagoon lay safety, security, and peace. In its treacherous labyrinth of shallow channels, all would-be attackers floundered and sank. Beyond lay opportunity, but also danger. The Lidi were the frontier between two worlds, the known and the unknown, the world that was safe and the one that was dangerous. In the Republic's founding myth, St. Mark was surprised by a squall and found peace only within the lagoon, but the voyage beyond was not optional. For the Venetians, the sea was life and death, and the Senza acknowledged the pact. Ascension Day marked the start of the sailing season, when mariners could be hopeful of a calm voyage. Yet the waters of the Adriatic were notoriously fickle at any time of year. They could be smooth as silk, or whipped into choppy fury by the bora, the north wind. The Romans, no great sailors, were frightened of it. The Adriatic nearly drowned Julius Caesar, and the poet Horace thought there was nothing to equal the terror of the waves dashing the cliffs of southern Albania. Oared galleys could be quickly swamped by a mounting sea. Sailing ships running before the wind had little room for maneuver in the narrow straits. There is no more vivid historical account of the sea's ferocity than the fate of a Norman fleet crossing to Albania in the early summer of 1081. There was a heavy fall of snow, and winds blowing furiously from the mountains lashed up the sea. There was a howling noise as the waves built up. Oars snapped off as the rowers plunged them into the water. The sails were torn to shreds by the blast. Yardarms were crushed and fell on the decks. and now ships were being swallowed up, crew and all. Some of the ships sank, and their crews drowned with them. Others were dashed against the headlands and broke up. Many corpses were thrown up by the waves. The sea was tumultuous, dangerous, pirate-infested. The Venetians fought unceasingly to keep their seaway to the world open. Even the Lidi were no certain guarantee of protection. Because the Adriatic is a cul-de-sac, it feels the moon's tug with a special force, and when the phases are right and the Sirocco, the wind from Africa, pushes the water up the Venetian Gulf and the opposing Bora, hard off the Hungarian steppes, holds it back, the lagoon itself is under threat. In folk memory, the events of late January 1106 emphasize the force of the sea. People remembered that the Sirocco had been blowing up from the south with unusual force. The weather became unnervingly sultry, day after day sucking the energy out of men and beasts. There were unmistakable signs of approaching storm. House walls oozed moisture. The sea started to groan and gave off the strange neutral smell of electricity. Birds skittered and squawked. Eels leaped clear of the water as if trying to flee. When at last the storm broke, shattering thunder shook the houses and torrential rain hammered the lagoon. The sea rose up from its depths, overwhelmed the Lidi, poured through the openings of the lagoon, and swamped the city. It demolished houses, ruined merchandise, destroyed food stocks, drowned animals, strewed the small fields with sterile salt. An entire island, the ancient town of Malamocco, vanished, leaving ghostly foundations visible through the murky water at low tide. Hard on the Adriatic's heels came devastating fires that ripped through the wooden settlements, leaping the Grand Canal, incinerating 24 churches, and gutting a major part of the city. "Venice was rocked to its very core," wrote the chronicler Andrea Dandolo. Venice's hold on the material world was fragile. It lived with impermanence. It was against such forces that people felt their vulnerability and made sacrificial offerings. The Doge's assumption of their new title, Dux Dalmatiae, marked a moment of unparalleled change in the sea power of the Eastern Mediterranean. For 400 years, the Adriatic itself had been ruled from Rome. For another 600, the sea, and Venice itself, had been subject to Rome's Greek-speaking successor, the Byzantine emperors in Constantinople. By the year 1000, this power was starting to wane, and the Venetians were engaged in a stealthy act of substitution. In the small stone cathedrals of Zara, Spalato, Istria, and Trau, the Venetian Doge was remembered in prayers only after the name of the emperor in Constantinople. But this practice was simply a ritual. The emperor was far away. His power no longer stretched much north of Corfu, at the gates of the Adriatic and along the Italian shore. The lords of Dalmatia were in all fact the Venetians. The power vacuum created by weakening Byzantine control would allow Venice to move up the scale progressively from subjects to equal partners, and finally, in tragic circumstances, to usurpers of the Byzantine Sea. The lords of the Dalmatian coast were embarked on the ascent. The relationship between Byzantium and Venice was one of intense complexity and longevity, chafed by mutually contradictory views of the world and subject to wild mood swings. Yet Venice always looked to Constantinople. This was the great city of the world, the gateway to the East. Through its warehouses on the Golden Horn flowed the wealth of the wider world. Russian furs, wax, slaves and caviar, spices from India and China, ivory, silk, precious stones and gold. Out of these materials, Byzantine craftsmen fashioned extraordinary objects, both sacred and profane. Reliquaries, mosaics, chalices chased with emeralds, costumes of shot silk that formed the taste of Venice. The astonishing Basilica of St. Mark, reconsecrated in 1094, was designed by Greek architects on the pattern of the Church of the Holy Apostles in Constantinople. Its artisans recounted the story of St. Mark, stone by stone, in imitation of the mosaic styles of St. Sophia, Hagia Sophia. Its goldsmiths and enamelers created the Palla d'Oro, the golden altarpiece, a miraculous expression of Byzantine devotion and art. The whiff of spices on the quays of Venice had been carried 1,000 miles from the godowns of the Golden Horn. Constantinople was Venice's souk, where its merchants gathered to make and lose fortunes. As loyal subjects of the emperor, the right to trade in his lands was always their most precious possession. He, in turn, used this privilege as the bargaining chip to rein in his uppity vassals. In 991, Orseolo gained valuable trading rights for Venetian support in the Adriatic. 25 years later, they were tetchily withdrawn again in a spat. Differing attitudes to commerce marked a sharp dividing line. From early on, the amoral trading mentality of the Venetians, the assumed right to buy and sell anything to anyone, shocked the pious Byzantines. Around 820, the emperor complained bitterly about Venetian cargoes of war materials, timber, metal, and slaves, to his enemy, the Sultan in Cairo. But in the last quarter of the 11th century, the Byzantine Empire, such a durable presence in the Mediterranean basin, started to decline, and the balance of power began tilting in Venice's favor. In the 1080s, the Venetians defended the empire in the Adriatic against powerful Norman war bands, intent on taking Constantinople itself. Their reward was sumptuous. With all the imperial pomp of Byzantine ritual, the emperor affixed his golden seal, the Bulla Aurea, to a document that would change the sea forever. He granted the city's merchants the rights to trade freely, exempt from tax, throughout his realms. A large number of cities and ports were specified by name: Athens and Salonica, Thebes and Antioch and Ephesus, the islands of Chios and Euboea, key harbors along the coasts of southern Greece such as Modon and Coron, invaluable staging posts for Venetian galleys, but above all, Constantinople itself. Here, Venice was given a prize site by the Golden Horn. It included 3 quays, a church and bakery, shops and warehouses for storing goods. Though nominal subjects of the emperor, the Venetians had effectively acquired their own colony, with all the necessary infrastructure, in the heart of the richest city on earth, under extremely favorable conditions. Only the Black Sea, Constantinople's grain basket, was barred to the avid traders. Quietly echoing among the solemn, convoluted lines of the Byzantine decree was the sweetest Greek word a Venetian might ever want to hear: monopoly. Venice's jostling rivals in maritime trade, Genoa, Pisa, and Amalfi, were now put at such disadvantage that their presence in Constantinople was almost futile. The Golden Bull of 1082 was the golden key that opened up the treasure house of Eastern trade for Venice. Its merchants flocked to Constantinople. Others started to permeate the small ports and harbors of the eastern seaboard. By the second half of the 12th century, Venetian merchants were visible everywhere in the eastern Mediterranean. Their colony in Constantinople grew to around 12,000, and decade by decade, the trade of Byzantium imperceptibly passed into their hands. They not only funneled goods back to an avid market in continental Europe, they acted as intermediaries, restlessly shuttling back and forth across the ports of the Levant, buying and selling. Their ships triangulated the eastern seas, shipping olive oil from Greece to Constantinople, buying linen in Alexandria and selling it to the Crusader states via Acre, touching Crete and Cyprus, Smyrna and Salonica. At the mouth of the Nile, in the ancient city of Alexandria, they bought spices in exchange for slaves, endeavoring at the same time to perform a nimble balancing act between the Byzantines and the Crusaders on one hand, and their enemy, the Fatimid dynasty in Egypt, on the other. With each passing decade, Venice was sinking its tentacles deeper into the trading posts of the East. Its wealth saw the rise of a new class of rich merchants. Many of the great families of Venetian history began their ascent to prominence during the boom years of the 12th century. The period heralded the start of commercial dominance. With this wealth came arrogance and resentment. "They came," said a Byzantine chronicler, "in swarms and tribes, exchanging their city for Constantinople, whence they spread out across the empire." The tone of these remarks speaks a familiar language of xenophobia and economic fear of the immigrant. The upstart Italians, with their hats and their beardless faces, stood out sharply, both in manner and appearance, in the city streets. The charges leveled against the Venetians were many. They acted like citizens of a foreign power, rather than loyal subjects of the empire. They were fanning out from their allotted quarter and were buying properties across the city. They cohabitated with or married Greek women and led them away from the Orthodox faith. They stole the relics of saints. They were wealthy, arrogant, unruly, boorish, out of control. Morally dissolute, vulgar, untrustworthy, with all the gross characteristics of seafaring people, spluttered another Byzantine writer. A bishop of Salonica called them marsh frogs. The Venetians were becoming increasingly unpopular in the Byzantine Empire, and they seemed to be everywhere. In the larger geopolitics of the 12th century, the relationship between the Byzantines and their errant subjects was marked by ever more violent oscillations between the poles of love and hate. The Venetians were insufferable, but indispensable. The Byzantines, who complacently still saw themselves as the center of the world, and for whom land ownership was more glorious than vulgar commerce, had given away their trade to the lagoon dwellers and allowed their navy to decline. They became increasingly dependent on Venice for maritime defense. The imperial policy toward the pushy foreigners veered erratically. The emperor's one throttle on them was control of trading rights. Repeated attempts were made over a century to loosen Venice's hold on the Byzantine economy by playing the Republic off against its commercial rivals, Pisa and Genoa. In 1111, the Pisans were also granted trading rights in Constantinople. 45 years later, the Genoese were similarly admitted. Each was awarded tax breaks, a commercial quarter, and landing stages in Constantinople. The city was a crucible for fierce rivalry between the Italian republics that would, in time, flare into full-scale trade wars. When the Spanish Jew Benjamin Tudela came to Constantinople in 1176, he found a tumultuous city. Men come to trade there from all countries by land and by sea. The city became a claustrophobic arena for competition. Ugly brawls broke out between competing nationalities, hemmed into adjacent enclaves along the banks of the Golden Horn. The Venetians were jealous of their monopolies, which they felt had been earned in the Norman Wars of the last century. They deeply resented the manner in which successive emperors rescinded them or favored their rivals. The Italians had become, in the eyes of the ruling Greeks, an uncontrollable nuisance. A race characterized by a lack of breeding, which is totally at variance with our noble sense of order, they pronounced with aristocratic hauteur. In 1171, Emperor Manuel I took the whole Venetian population in its empire hostage and detained it for years. The crisis took 2 decades to resolve and left a bitter legacy of mutual mistrust. By the time Venetian merchants were expelled, then readmitted to Constantinople in the 1190s, any special relationship was dead. It was against this background that the Pope called for a new crusade in the summer of 1198. Chapter 2, The Blind Doge, 1198-1201. The Fourth Crusade opened with a furious blast. After the miserable destruction of the territory of Jerusalem, after the mournful massacre of the Christian people, after the deplorable invasion of the land on which had stood the feet of Christ and where God our Father had seen fit before recorded time to work out salvation in the middle of the earth, the apostolic seat, the papacy, disquieted by the misfortune of such great calamity, was sorely troubled. It cries out and raises its voice like a trumpet, desiring to arouse the Christian people to fight Christ's fight and to avenge the outrage against him who was crucified. Therefore, my sons, take up the spirit of fortitude, put on the shield of faith, the helmet of salvation, trusting not in numbers nor in brute force, but rather in the power of God. The ringing call to militant Christendom, launched by Pope Innocent III in August 1198, came an ominous century after the successful capture of Jerusalem. In the interim, the whole crusading project had slid toward collapse. The decisive blow fell in 1187, when Saladin shattered a crusader army at Hattin and retook the holy city. Neither the Holy Roman Emperor, Frederick Barbarossa, who drowned in a Syrian river, nor the English king, Richard the Lionheart, had come close to regaining it. The crusaders were now confined to a few settlements along the coast, such as the ports of Tyre and Acre. It fell to the Pope to breathe life back into the project. Innocent was 37 years old, young, brilliant, determined, pragmatic, a master of religious rhetoric and a skilled jurist. His call to arms was both a military venture, a campaign of moral rearmament in a secularizing world, and an initiative to reassert papal authority. From the start, he made it clear that he intended not only to raise the crusade, but to direct it himself through the offices of his papal legates. While one went to stir up the warrior lords of northern France, the other, Cardinal Sofredo, came to Venice to ask about ships. A century of crusading had taught military planners that the land route to Syria was an arduous trudge, and that the Byzantines were hostile to large numbers of armed men tramping across their terrain. With the other maritime republics, Pisa and Genoa, at war, only Venice had the skill, the resources, and the technology to transport a whole army to the east. The immediate Venetian response was startling. They sent their own legates back to Rome to request, as a preliminary, the lifting of the papal ban on trading with the Islamic world, specifically Egypt. The Republic's case framed at the outset the collision of faith and secular necessity that was to haunt the Fourth Crusade. It rested on the prototype definition of Venetian identity. The legates argued the issue of their city's unique situation. It had no agriculture. It depended entirely on trade for its survival and was being badly hurt by the embargo, which it faithfully observed. The legates might also have muttered under their breath that Pisa and Genoa had meanwhile continued their trade in defiance of the papacy, but Innocent was not impressed. The city had long existed at an oblique angle to pious Christian projects. Eventually, he gave the Venetians a carefully worded permission, framed to exclude transaction in any war materials, which he proceeded to enumerate. "We prohibit you, under strict threat of anathema, to supply the Saracens by selling, giving, or bartering iron, hemp, sharp implements, inflammable materials, arms, galleys, sailing ships, or timbers," adding with a lawyer's precision to close up any legal loopholes the devious Venetians might seek to exploit, "whether finished or unfinished." Innocent then issued a stern warning. "Hoping that because of this concession you will be strongly moved to provide help to the province of Jerusalem and making sure that you do not try any fraud against the apostolic decree. Because there cannot be the slightest doubt that he who tries fraudulently against his own conscience to cheat this order will be bound tight by divine sentence." This was not a good start. The threat of excommunication was heavy, and Innocent did not trust Venice at all. But practically, he had no choice but to bend a little. Only the Republic could supply the ships. So it was that when six French knights arrived in Venice in the first week of Lent 1201, the Doge probably had a good idea of their mission. They came as envoys of the great crusading counts of France and the Low Countries, from Champagne, Brie, Flanders, Hainaut, and Blois, with sealed charters that gave them full authority to make whatever agreements they saw fit for maritime transport. One of these men was Geoffroy de Villardouin of Champagne, a veteran of the Third Crusade and a man with experience of assembling Crusader armies. It was Villardouin's account that would form a principal but highly partial source for all that followed. Venice had a long tradition of equating age with experience when it came to appointing doges, but the man the counts had come to see was remarkable by any measure. Enrico Dandolo was the scion of a prominent family of lawyers, merchants, and churchmen. They had been intertwined in nearly all the great events of the past century and had built up an impressive record of service to the Republic. They had been involved in reforming the city's church and state institutions in the middle years of the 12th century and had participated in Venice's crusading ventures. By all accounts, the male Dandolos were a clan of immense wisdom, energy, and longevity. In 1201, Enrico was over 90. He was also completely blind. No one knows what Enrico looked like. His physical image has been shaped by numerous anachronistic portrayals, so it is easy now to imagine a tall, thin, wiry man with a white beard and piercing but sightless eyes, steely in his resolve for the Venetian state, sagacious with experience of many decades at the heart of Venice's life during a century of rising prosperity, an impression for which there is no material substance. Of his personality, contemporary impressions and subsequent judgments have been sharply divided. They would match the divergent views of Venice itself. To his friends, Dandolo would become the epitome of the Republic's shrewdness and good government. To the French knight Robert of Clary, he was a most worthy man and wise. To Abbot Martin of Paris, a man who compensated for physical blindness with a lively intellect. The French Count Hugh of St. Paul called him prudent in character, discreet and wise in making difficult decisions. Villardouin, who came to know him well, declared him to be very wise, brave, and vigorous. To the Greek chronicler Niketas Koniates, who did not, he was destined to a counter-judgment which also has passed into the bloodstream of history. A man most treacherous and hostile to the Byzantines, both cunning and arrogant, he called himself the wisest of the wise, and in his lust for glory surpassed everyone. Around Dandolo would gather accretions of myth that would define less the man than the way that Venice would be seen both by itself and its enemies. Dandolo had always been destined for high office, but sometime in the mid-1170s, he started to lose his sight. Documents that he signed in 1174 show a firm, legible signature well aligned along the page. Another in 1176 bears the telltale signs of visual impairment. The words of the Latin formula, "I, Henry Dandolo, judge, have signed underneath in my hand," slope away downhill to the right as the writer's grasp of spatial relationship falters across the page, each successive letter taking its stumbling position from an increasingly uncertain guess as to the orientation of its predecessor. It appears that Dandolo's eyesight was slowly fading, and in time, utterly extinguished. Eventually, according to Venetian statute, Dandolo was no longer permitted to sign documents, only to have his mark attested by an approved witness. The nature, the degree, and the cause of Dandolo's loss of sight were destined to become subjects of much speculation, and to be held as a key explanation for the events of the Fourth Crusade. It was rumored that during the Byzantine hostage crisis of 1172, when Dandolo was in Constantinople, the Emperor Manuel ordered his eyes to be blinded with glass, and his eyes were uninjured, but he saw nothing. This was stated as the reason why the Doge harbored a profound grudge against the Byzantines. In another version, he lost his sight in a street brawl in Constantinople. Variants of this tale perplexed the medieval world in all subsequent considerations of Dandolo's career. Some held that his blindness was feigned, or not total, for his eyes were attested to be indeed still bright and clear, and how otherwise was Dandolo able to lead the Venetian people in peace and war? Conversely, it was said that he was adept at covering up his blindness, and that this was proof of the treacherous cunning of the man. It is certain, however, that Dandolo was not blinded in 1172. His signature was still good 2 years later, nor did he himself ever apportion blame for it. The only explanation that he subsequently gave was that he had lost his sight through a blow to the head. However it happened, his blindness did nothing to dim the clarity of his judgment or his energy. In 1192, Dandolo was elected to the position of Doge and swore the ducal oath of office to work for the honor and profit of the Venetians in good faith and without fraud. Despite the fact that Venice, always profoundly conservative in its mechanisms, was never given to a heady admiration of youth, the blind man who had to be led to the ducal throne remained an unusual choice. It is possible he was viewed as a stopgap. Given his advanced years, the electors could feel reasonably confident that his term of office would be short. None of them could have guessed that it had 13 years to run, during which time he would transform the future of Venice, or that the arrival of the Crusader knights would be the trigger. Dandolo welcomed the knights warmly, examined their letters of credence carefully, and being satisfied with their authority, proceeded to the business. The matter was unfolded in a series of meetings, first to the Doge and his council, inside the Doge's palace, which was very fine and beautiful, according to Villardouin. The barons were highly impressed with the splendor of the setting and the dignity of the blind Doge, a very wise and venerable man. They had come, they said, because they could be confident of finding a greater supply of ships at Venice than at any other port. And they outlined their request for transport, the number of men and horses, the provisions, the length of time for which they requested them. Dandolo was evidently taken aback by the scale of the operation that the envoys outlined, though it is unclear exactly how detailed the projections were. It was a week's work for the Venetians to size up the task. They came back and named their terms. With the thoroughness of experienced workmen quoting on a job, they stipulated exactly what they would supply for the money. "We will build horse transports to carry 4,500 horses and 9,000 squires, and 4,500 knights and 20,000 foot soldiers will be embarked on ships. And our terms will include provisions for both men and horses for 9 months. This is the minimum we will provide, conditional on payment of 4 marks per horse and 2 per man. And all the terms we are setting out for you will be valid for a year from the day of departure from the port of Venice to serve God and Christendom, wherever that may take us. The sum of money specified above totals 94,000 marks. And we will additionally supply 50 armed galleys free of charge, for as long as our alliance lasts, with the condition that we receive half of all the conquests that we make, either by way of territory or money, either by land or at sea. Now take counsels among yourselves as to whether you are willing and able to go ahead with this." The per capita rate was not unreasonable. The Genoese had asked for similar from the French in 1190, but the aggregate sum of 94,000 marks was staggering, equivalent to the annual income of France. From the Venetian point of view, the venture was a huge commercial opportunity, shadowed by considerable risk. It would require the undivided attention of the whole Venetian economy for 2 years, a year of preparation, shipbuilding, logistical arrangements, manpower recruitment, food sourcing, followed by a second year of active service by a sizable section of the male population, and the use of all the Republic's ships. It would commit the Venetians to the largest commercial contract in medieval history. It would mean the cessation of all other trading activity during the span of the contract. Failure at any point would mean disaster for the city, because all its resources were involved. It was small wonder that Dandolo had studied the letters of authority so closely, drawn the contract so carefully, and asked for half of the proceeds. The two dimensions were time and money. Both had been scrupulously weighed. The Venetians were seasoned merchants. Contracting was what they did, and they believed in the sanctity of the deal. It was the gold standard by which Venetian life operated. Its key parameters were quantity, price, and delivery date. Such bargains were hammered out in the Rialto every day of the trading year, though never on this scale. The Doge might have been surprised that the Crusaders agreed so readily after only an overnight consideration. The envoys were particularly impressed by the Venetian offer to contribute 50 galleys at their own expense. It was not without significance. Neither was the seemingly innocuous phrase, "wherever that may take us," inserted into the contract without purpose. The Doge might have been driving the deal, but Venice defined itself as a commune, in which all the people theoretically had a say in the major decisions of the state. In this case, their whole future was at stake. It was critical to obtain wide consent for the deal. Villardouin recorded the process of Venetian democracy at work. The transaction had to be sold to an ever-widening audience, first to the Great Council of 50, then to 200 representatives of the commune. Finally, Dandolo called the general populace to St. Mark's Basilica. According to Villardouin, 10,000 people were gathered together in expectation of dramatic news. In the smoky darkness of the great mother church, the most beautiful church that might be, wrote Villardouin, who was evidently as susceptible as anyone to the atmosphere of the place, glimmering like a sea cave shot through with shafts of obscure light and the smoldering gold of its mosaic saints, Dandolo constructed a scene of mounting drama, using his intelligence and powers of reason, which were both very sound and sharp. First, he requested a mass to the Holy Spirit, and to beg God that he might guide them concerning the request the envoys had made to them. Then the six envoys entered the great doors of the church and walked down the aisle. The Frenchmen, doubtless wearing their surcoats emblazoned with the scarlet cross, were the object of intense interest. People craned and jostled to catch a glimpse of the foreigners. Clearing his throat, Villardouin made a powerful address to his audience. "My lords, the greatest and most powerful barons of all France have sent us to you. They have begged your mercy to take pity on Jerusalem, which is enslaved by the Turks, so that, for the love of God, you should be willing to help their expedition to avenge Jesus Christ's dishonor. And for this, they have chosen you, because there is no nation so powerful at sea as you, and they have ordered us to throw ourselves at your feet and not to get up until you have agreed to take pity on the Holy Land overseas." The marshal flattered their maritime pride and their religious zeal, as if they had been personally called upon by God to perform this mighty deed. All six envoys fell weeping to the floor. It was an appeal direct to the emotional core of the medieval soul. A thunderous roar swept through the church, along the nave, mounting to the galleries and up into the swirling heights of the dome. People called out with one voice and raised their hands up high and cried, "We agree, we agree!" Dandolo was then helped to the pulpit, his sightless eyes sensing the moment, and sealed the pact. "My lords, behold the honor God has done you, because the finest nation on earth has scorned all others and asked your help and cooperation in undertaking a task of such great importance as the deliverance of our Lord." It was irresistible. The Treaty of Venice, as it came to be known, was signed and sealed the following day with all due ceremony. The Doge gave the envoys his charters, weeping copiously, and swore in good faith on the relics of saints to loyally hold to the terms in the charters. The envoys responded in kind, sent messengers to Pope Innocent, and departed to prepare for the crusade. Under the terms of the treaty, the crusading army would be gathered on the auspicious St. John's Day, June 24th, the following year, 1202, and the fleet would be ready to receive them. Despite the fervent assent of the population, the Venetians were, by nature, a cautious people, in whom the mercantile spirit had bred shrewd judgment. They were not given to flights of fancy, and Dandolo was a cautious leader. Yet any measured risk analysis of the Treaty of Venice would suggest that it involved hazarding the whole economy of the commune on one high-stakes project. the number of men and ships required, the sums of money to be laid out. The figures were breathtaking. Dandolo was over 90 years old, with presumably only a few years to live. He personally was responsible for pushing through this enormous project. On the face of it, he had much to lose. Why on earth should he risk his declining years in this gamble? The answers lay in the Venetian character, its peculiar admixture of the secular and religious, and in the treaty itself. Venice continuously looked back to the precedents of its history for received wisdom to steer the ship of state. Its rise over the previous century had been deeply entwined with the adventure of the Crusades. The Venetians had participated in the First Crusade and again in 1123. From both, they had profited in material terms. They had acquired a third of the city of Tyre in 1112, ruled directly from the lagoon on terms of tax-free trade, which marked the start of Venice's overseas empire, as well as a foothold in a string of other harbors. Beneath the pattern of intermittent holy wars, these Palestinian ports provided the Italian republics with new opportunities to acquire goods of the farthest Orient. They found themselves linked to a network of ancient trading routes that stretched all the way to China. Venice was also able to access a world of wealth and luxury within the Levant itself, where sophisticated manufacturing skills and agricultural expertise had been flourishing for hundreds of years. Tripoli was famous for the weaving of silk, Tyre for the vivid transparency of its glass, for its purple and red fabrics dyed in the vats of Jewish artisans, for sugarcane, lemons, oranges, figs, almonds, olives, and sesame. Via the port of Acre, one could acquire medicinal rhubarb from the River Volga, Tibetan musk, cinnamon and pepper, nutmeg, cloves, aloe and camphor, ivory from India and Africa, and Arabian dates. In Beirut, indigo, incense, pearls, and Brazil wood. The brilliant Levantine light had exposed Europeans to a tumbling world of bright colors and vivid scents. New tastes in goods, clothes, foods, and flavors permeated the Crusader kingdom and were carried back in the holds of merchant ships to an increasingly wealthy Europe. In return, Venice and its rivals also provisioned the Crusades. They brought the kingdom of Jerusalem, as well as its enemies in Egypt, the resources of war, arms, metal, wood, and horses, and the necessary goods to sustain colonial life on a foreign shore, and ballasted their ships with pilgrims eager to witness the holy places. For Venetian merchants, the Crusades had proved highly profitable. In the process, they deepened their knowledge of how to trade across a cultural divide, which would make them, in time, the interpreters of worlds. The expeditions to previous Crusades had entered the national memory as triumphant episodes in the litany of Venetian glories. They reinforced the city's sense of itself and its expectations. Venice had always looked east into the rising sun, for trade and booty, for material objects with which to embellish the city, for the stolen bones of Christian saints, for the possibility of wealth and military glory, and not least, for the remission of sins. Venice's attachment to the east was aesthetic, religious, and commercial. The returning argosies set a pattern of expectation, that what would be unloaded at the basin of St. Mark would enrich, ennoble, and sanctify the city. 100 years earlier, a doge had raised to the status of patriotic duty the demand that merchant ships returning from the east should bring back antiquities, marbles, and carvings for the decoration of the newly rebuilt Church of St. Mark. A successful expedition in 1123 had given the Republic lively expectations of the commercial benefits that might be derived from the Crusades. In the newly drawn Treaty of Venice, the maritime contract alone would give a good profit, and half of all the spoils might yield unknown wealth. As a youth, Dandolo had probably personally witnessed the religious fervor and national pride that had accompanied the departure of crusading fleets, and heard the impassioned words of the doge of his childhood extolling their spiritual and material glory. Venetians, With what immortal glory and splendor will your name be covered from this expedition? What reward will you gain from God? You will win the admiration of Europe and Asia. The standard of Saint Mark will fly triumphantly in far-off lands. New prophets, new sources of greatness will come to this most noble city. Roused by the holy zeal of religion, excited by the example of all Europe, hurry to arms. Think of the honor and the prizes. Think of your triumph with the blessings of heaven. Dandolo had other personal reasons for committing Venice to a new crusade. He came from a family of crusaders. Probably a desire to emulate his forefathers struck a deep chord in him. And he was an old man. Concern for his soul would also have weighed heavily. The promised absolution of sins was one of the most powerful incentives for the Crusades. He had compelling national, personal, spiritual, and family motives for signing the treaty. The blind but percipient Doge had evidently glimpsed a moment of destiny, as if everything in Venetian history had led up to this extraordinary opportunity. But there was something else, buried at the heart of the treaty, which would have lent it considerable appeal. What was kept from all but a handful of signatories and the crusading lords back in France and Lombardy was that the expedition, which had stirred the rank and file vaguely to take pity on the Holy Land overseas, had no intention initially of going there. It was bound for Egypt. As Villardouin confessed in his chronicle, it was secretly agreed in closed council that we would go to Egypt, because via Cairo, one could more easily destroy the power of the Turks than by anywhere else. But publicly, it was just announced that we were going overseas. There were sound strategic reasons for this approach. It had long been recognized by shrewder military tacticians that the wealth of Egypt was a reservoir of resource for the Muslim armies in Palestine and Syria. Saladin's victories had been built on the riches of Cairo and Alexandria. As Richard the Lionheart had realized, the keys to Jerusalem are to be found in Cairo. The problem was that such an oblique approach to recapturing the Holy City was unlikely to stir the popular imagination. The ardently pious sought salvation by fighting for the ground on which Jesus had stood, not strangling Islamic military supply lines in the souks of the Nile Delta. But to the Venetians, this strategy offered a further extension of commercial opportunity. Egypt was the wealthiest region in the Levant, and another natural access point to the highly lucrative spice routes. It promised richer commercial prizes than the harbors of Tyre and Acre could ever provide. Whatever this part of the world lacks in the matter of pearls, spices, oriental treasures, and foreign wares is brought hither from the two Indies, Saba, Arabia, and both the Ethiopias, as well as from Persia and other lands nearby, wrote William of Tyre 20 years earlier. People from east and west flock thither in great numbers, and Alexandria is a public market for both worlds. In fact, Venice had a poor share of this market, despite the recent permission from Pope Innocent. Genoa and Pisa dominated the trade with Egypt. Dandolo had been to Alexandria. He knew firsthand both its wealth and its defensive frailties, and the city held a powerful emotional attraction for the Republic. It was here that Saint Mark had died, and whence Venetian merchants had spirited away his bones. In essence, a victorious campaign in Egypt, with half the proceeds as reward, gave Venice a glimpse of riches that might far exceed all its previous commercial triumphs. It could, at a stroke, deliver a large part of the commerce of the Eastern Mediterranean into its grasp and permanently discomfit its maritime rivals. Tax-free monopoly trading was an irresistible lure. The potential returns were evidently worth the risk, and this was why the Venetians had thrown in 50 war galleys at their own expense. They were not designed to fight sea battles off the coast of Palestine, but to nose their way up the shallow, reedy deltas of the Nile for a strike against Cairo. This secret agenda was just one worrying coordinate of a treaty that was destined to exert a malign influence on the Crusade. The others were time. The Venetians had committed themselves finally to a 9-month finite maritime contract, from St. John's Day, June 24, 1202, and crucially, money. It seems likely that the final agreed sum was knocked down to 85,000 marks, still a staggering amount. Even if the per capita rate was reasonable, Villehardouin's estimate of 33,000 crusaders was exceptionally high. Villehardouin had experience of estimating crusader armies, but his overnight acceptance of the Doge's terms would prove a colossal blunder. He had dramatically miscalculated the number of crusaders who could be assembled. He had also failed to realize that those on whose behalf he had signed the treaty were not themselves bound to it. They were under no obligation to sail from Venice. The crusade was under financial pressure from the start. Innocent had attempted and failed to raise funds through taxation. The 6 delegates had to borrow the first down payment on the deal, 2,000 marks, on the Rialto. Though no one knew it at the time, the Treaty of Venice contained the active ingredients for serious trouble, which would render the Fourth Crusade the most controversial event of medieval Christendom. Villehardouin jingled his way back over the Alpine passes. The crusaders of France, Flanders, and northern Italy, the Franks, as the Byzantines referred to them, made their vows and their wills, donned their surcoats, and laboriously began the long, tedious preparations for departure. In the lagoon, the Venetians set to work preparing the largest fleet in its history. Chapter 3. 34,000 marks, 1201 to 1202. The scale of the operation dwarfed any of the city's previous maritime expeditions. It required Dandolo to order the immediate suspension of all other commercial activities and to recall merchant vessels from overseas as the whole population threw itself into the preparations. They had 13 months to complete the work. The shipbuilding and refurbishment alone were a huge project, which required immense quantities of wood, pitch, hemp, ropes, sailcloth, and iron for nails, anchors, and fixings. The Italian mainland was scoured for resources. Quantities of fir and larch were floated down the rivers that fed into the lagoon. Oak and pine came from the Veneto and the Dalmatian coast. The state arsenal, established in 1104, was the industrial hub of the work, but much of it was carried on in private yards scattered across the islands of the lagoon. The air rang with the sound of hammering and sawing, the blows of axes and the rasping of adzes. Cauldrons of pitch bubbled and steamed. Forges glowed. Rope makers paid out hundreds of yards of twisted hemp. Oars, pulleys, masts, sails, and anchors were shaped, hewed, sewn, and forged. Ships started to grow from the keel up. Others were refitted or adapted. In the arsenal, war machines were under construction, stone-throwing catapults and siege towers in kit form, which could be dismantled for the voyage. The logistical requirements of the crusade demanded vessels of different types. The 4,500 knights and 20,000 foot soldiers would be carried in round ships, high-sided sailing vessels with fore and aft castles, of varying size from a handful of immense prestige ships, assigned to the nobility, to the standard crusader transports that crammed 600 men below decks, then down to smaller craft. The 4,500 horses would be carried in 150 specially adapted oared galleys, fitted with hinged landing doors either in the side or the bows, up which the horses could be walked into the belly of the vessels, then secured in slings to counteract the rolling motion of the sea. The doors, which would be below the waterline, had to be caulked shut for the voyage, but could be swung open on a shelving beach to permit a fully armored knight to ride out, terrifying any unsuspecting foe. In total, the Venetians probably had to provide 450 ships to carry the army and all its impedimenta. Then there were the 50 galleys, which the Venetians themselves would provide, and the recruitment of sailors and oarsmen to man the fleet. To row and sail 33,500 men across the eastern Mediterranean required another 30,000 maritime specialists, half the adult population of Venice, or replacements recruited from the seagoing cities of the Dalmatian coast. Many volunteered as crusaders, but the numbers still had to be made up. Men from each parish of the city were impressed by a lottery drawn using wax balls. Those who drew a ball containing a scrap of paper were ordered to the Republic's service. A parallel effort of hardly less magnitude was required to provision the armada. The Venetians carefully quantified the provisions for each man for a year. 377 kilos of bread and flour, 2,000 kilos of cereals and beans, 300 liters of wine. The mathematics of provisioning a crusader army stacked up huge numbers. The agricultural hinterland of Venice was scoured for produce. Wheat was secured from regional centers, Bologna, Cremona, Imola, and Faenza, and double-baked in Venetian ovens to make the durable ship's biscuit, which formed the staple of the maritime diet. Not all this food would have been sourced in Venice. Undoubtedly, Venetian planners sought to reprovision along the way as they sailed down the coast of Dalmatia, but fulfilling the contract was an enormous challenge.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.